Evergreening means keeping something forever fresh and green. It sounds good, doesn't it? But it has another meaning. It refers to drug patents and the method used by the pharmaceutical industry to increase profits at the expense of sick people. So how does it work? When a drug company develops a new medicine, they get a patent as compensation. This gives the company the exclusive right to manufacture and sell their drug. No other companies can do this for up to 20 years. So the drug companies that own the patents can set prices as high as they like because there is no market competition for up to 20 years. The expectation is that these monopoly rights will help stimulate and encourage the invention of new medicines for the benefit of humanity. When a patent on a medicine expires, other companies can produce that medicine and compete. So the price gradually falls to the point where ordinary patients and health schemes can buy it. But the reality is very different. Patents are not encouraging innovation in the pharmaceutical industry. First, most innovations are the result of research work that is funded by taxpayers. And each year, very few really new medicines come onto the market. Most supposedly new medicines are minor modifications of old medicines, with nothing new, no breakthroughs, and little improved effectiveness. Seeking patents on such drugs is a tactic that helps companies to extend monopolies for another 20 years, so they can preserve high profits for even longer. This strategy is called evergreening, or endless patents. Let's look into this. Companies may apply for patents when they combine two old medicines together into what is called a combination. For example, the antiretroviral HIV drug, zidovudine, was combined with lamivudine into a single pill for the convenience of patients. A new formulation of a medicine may change a pill that used to be taken 3 times a day into a sustained-release pill taken once a day, again for convenience. But the drug has the same efficacy as before, or a new composition may change the original medicine to make it more liquid. These changes are used by companies to claim new patent applications. The discovery of new uses in treatment for old medicines may lead to abusive patent applications as new medicines. For example, aspirin was originally used for reducing fever, but later an application for an additional patent was made to use the same drug to prevent blood clotting. This kind of patent application does not involve the development of any new medicine at all. A medicine with the same original active ingredient and with the same therapeutic effect may be changed from what is called ethers and esters to become more soluble. Although the therapeutic effect has not changed, a new patent may be applied for. An original active ingredient, but with a newly discovered rearrangement of its structure, or what is called a polymorph, may become more soluble and stable, but the therapeutic effect has not changed. Again, an application may be made for a new patent to extend the monopoly period. This structural rearrangement, or what is called a polymorph, can be compared to 5 cups, where the structures can be in any one, but it is still the same active ingredient. But more concerning is applications for broad patents covering all possible chemical structures. The researcher knows only the basic core and some elements of the substance, but covers them all in order to block others from developing chemical entities with the same basic core. This is known as Marcouche claim. A researcher develops a chemical entity with a single basic core with 4 branches, but without knowing the performance of these 4 branches. The company may file a patent application that covers both the basic core and all the branches in order to block other researchers from developing anything from the basic core that it had discovered. This is an important barrier to the development of new medicines. In the pharmaceutical industry globally, we find that in the past 10 to 20 years, there have been very few inventions of new medicines, while the system of evergreening patents has been growing and growing every year. For example, in Thailand, there has been an 84% increase in the number of evergreening patent applications from major industrialized countries, such as the US, Germany, Switzerland, and France, while only 0.6% of patent applications are from Thai researchers. Some essential medicines, such as atorvastatin, used to lower blood cholesterol, have up to 10 such patent applications. Metformin, the old medicine used to treat diabetes, has up to 13 patent applications. The effect is to greatly extend the lifetime of the original patent up to 40 years, although it should not be like that. What is very troubling is that medicines for chronic illnesses, such as the antiretroviral medicines atazanavir, tenofovir, or efavirenz, are all the subject of such patent applications. It is certain that generic medicines cannot compete in the market because of such unmerited patents. It means that states responsible for the costs of public health have to use a higher proportion of already tight budgets on medicine, or they will have to ration medicine. If we calculate the expenditure on just the 50 most used medicines in Thailand, we find that over the next 20 years, the state will have to spend 8 billion baht, over $220 million, much of which could be saved if other drug companies could compete on cost. When the state cannot cover such increasing costs, patients will have less access to essential medicines, especially patients with chronic illnesses, such as people living with HIV or heart disease, who must take medicines for the rest of their lives. What is more, the extended patent monopolies will prevent local researchers from working on new medicines. If the domestic industry cannot produce new replacement medicines for the market, how can countries such as Thailand become self-reliant in medicines? This is not just a problem for Thailand. It is a problem for almost every country. The World Health Organization has recommended that countries should be careful before granting patents, using a manual with clear guidelines on the management of evergreening patent applications. India has clearly specified in its patent law a procedure for revoking evergreening patents. This procedure has been used to revoke patent applications on medicines for treating hepatitis C and for anti-leukemia medicines. In May 2012, the Argentinian government announced bold measures for state agencies to avoid patents being granted on minor modifications of old medicines in a bid to protect their national interests. At this time, we need countries to follow Argentina and India's example and be bold in tackling evergreening and unmerited patents.